Okay, so we're looking at the posterior side of the chain today, and we're gonna focus on the piriformis muscle, and more specifically, we're gonna focus on that muscle's role at the hip joint. So if you're looking here, you can see the palmar side of my finger, and then you're gonna see it disappear behind the sacrum here. And the reason that that's occurring is that the muscle, the piriformis, is going to attach all along the anterior surface of the sacrum, okay? And that's really unique for a muscle to attach on that anterior surface of the sacrum. So that's one unique thing about the piriformis. Another unique thing is that the muscle, the piriformis, is actually going to attach, you can see this blue mark here, to the superior aspect of the greater trochanter. So it's attaching right here. And that's really unique too, because the piriformis is one of a group of muscles called the deep six lateral rotators. So the piriformis attaches here. It's the only muscle of the deep six lateral rotators that attaches superiorly on the greater trochanter. And it might be hard to see there, but it's oriented more towards being anterior, which is going to make that muscle unique as far as the actions that it's capable of producing. Okay, so I'm going to throw one more thing out at you before we actually look at the muscle. If we look at the actual joint here, this is referred to as the femoral acetabular joint or the iliofemoral joint. You can see this deep socket here, it's called the acetabulum, so that's a concave surface. And then the head of the femur actually meets that concave surface. So you have this convex surface that's the head of the femur that meets the concave surface of the acetabulum, which is a part of the pelvis, okay? So we're gonna have motion in three different planes here because this is a ball and socket joint. And so the question is, do we have muscles that can actually allow the joint to centrate in every position that we would put the joint in? Okay, so that's something to ask. But another thing to look at is, because this is a skeleton, the head of the femur is dropping down, so you can see how it just kind of falls down here. Unlike you and I, there are no muscles or ligaments that are coming from various directions to hold the head of the femur on the acetabulum. I just wanted to point that out because when I put the piriformis muscle in there, you'll see that it's not exactly right because the head of the femur is dropping down. So we have to visualize that the head of the femur is actually where it's supposed to be when we're figuring out what the piriformis can and cannot do. Okay? So now let's look at that muscle. I'm going to put it on the anterior surface of the sacrum as best I can here. And then it's going to come over to the very top of the greater trochanter. So the muscle is called the piriformis and it's actually pear-shaped. So piriformis, pear-shaped like the fruit, because it's wider as it comes off the sacrum and then it gets narrower as it comes out to the femur or the landmark on the greater trochanter. So you can see and kind of get a visual how the muscle would actually run. But I'm going to bring it up just a little bit, because if we bring the head of the femur back to where it should be, that's about where the muscle would be. Okay, so try to remember that as we go through this, even though I'm going to show it a bunch of times. Okay, so I'm going to put an axis in there. Because we're dealing with a joint that allows for three planes of motion, we're going to have an axis that's going in this direction, and we're going to have an axis that's going in this direction, and then we're going to have an axis that's going in this direction. So first I'm going to start with this axis. So you can see that this axis is vertical, so you can imagine it coming out the other side of the joint. So we have a vertical axis at the hip joint. And then what's the muscle's relationship to that axis? So again, if I put the muscle back in here, again, it's on the anterior surface of the sacrum, and then bring it over to the trochanter, and then just bring it up slightly so you can envision if the head of the femur was on the acetabulum, it would be about there. So you can see that the muscle is actually posterior to that vertical axis. So what does that mean? Well, if the axis is here and the muscle's posterior to it, so it's behind it, what that means is that that muscle is going to pull the femur laterally. So you can imagine here, if the piriformis was to concentrically contract, it would pull the femur in this direction. So we would call that lateral rotation or external rotation. So again, the femur's here, the muscle shortens and pulls the femur or thigh in that direction. So we would call that external rotation or lateral rotation, both of which are occurring in what we would call the transverse plane. So that's a rotation that would be occurring in the transverse plane at the hip joint. Okay, so now we throw another axis in there, and this axis is going to be running from this direction, so through the hip joint, so it's running from posterior to anterior, imagine it going right through the joint again. And then what's the muscle's relationship to that axis? So if I put a muscle in here, you can see again running the same way, what's the muscle's relationship to that axis? And again, I'm going to bring the muscle up slightly here because that's where it actually would be if the head of the femur was on the acetabulum. So if the muscle's above that axis that's going in this direction, so we would call it an anterior posterior axis, okay, so it'd be going right through the joint, what would that muscle do? Well, if the piriformis was to concentrically contract, it would pull the femur in this direction. So we would call that abduction of the thigh at the hip joint. Okay. So again, imagine that muscle attaching on the greater trochanter. It concentrically contracts, and based on its relationship to that anterior-posterior axis, it abducts the thigh or femur at the hip joint. Okay, so now we're going to put another axis in there, the last one, and it's going to be going in this direction. So imagine it going right through the hip joint in this direction. So we would call that a medial lateral axis. Now the interesting thing about this axis in this position is if I put that muscle in there in the same way, so on the anterior surface of the sacrum, and then it comes over to the trochanter, and I'm going to bring that up slightly like I've been doing, can you see that that muscle doesn't really have a lot of leverage around that axis to create motion in what we would call the sagittal plane? But what if we take the femur or thigh out of anatomical position? That's going to change things in both directions, but I'm just going to go with the one direction today. So if I was to put this femur or thigh in a position of flexion, okay, and hold it there, you can see now we still have an axis going in this direction through the hip joint, so it's running from medial to lateral. We still have a muscle on the anterior surface of the sacrum, and it's coming over to the very top of the trochanter. Well, if you can imagine that femur going even higher than it is in that same direction. So right now, let's say the pelvis is here and the femur is at about 80 degrees of flexion. Well, if the femur was to go even higher, so let's say 90, 100, 110, even 120 degrees of flexion, you can see that that muscle would actually produce motion into flexion, but only when it's way outside of anatomical position. So when it's down here, it's not capable of doing much in that plane. But as we go into flexion, especially as we get closer to 90 and 110, 120, that muscle is capable of producing motion in the sagittal plane that we would refer to as flexion. Okay, now it's also possible for that muscle, if we go to the other extreme, again, not anatomical position, but the other end of anatomical position, it's also possible for that muscle to be involved in extension just based on the relationship of the axis. Okay, so just something to think about, just based on the muscle's relationship to the axis, that muscle could also play a role in extension when the femur is beyond anatomical position, meaning the femur is going closer to you rather than farther away from you. Okay, so that covers three planes. But now when we look at this position again, we can also put an axis in this direction. Okay, so we can go back to that axis that we started with, that vertical axis, and the axis is going through the same joint in this direction. And what's the muscle's relationship to that axis now? Well, if I put the muscle in here, it's again, it's attaching to the anterior surface of the sacrum, and it's coming over that same landmark on the trochanter. What's it capable of doing? Well, again, it's posterior to that vertical axis, and the hip joint just happens to be in a different position. So if the muscle's posterior to that axis, it's actually going to produce what would be called horizontal abduction. So the muscle is posterior to that vertical axis, and now it's capable of pulling the femur in that direction. So again, the femur is in a position of flexion. We'll say it's like 90 degrees of flexion. And the muscle, the piriformis, concentrically contracts to pull the femur again towards you, but it's going along the horizontal plane or transverse plane. So it's a vertical axis producing motion what we would call the transverse plane. So if you're not familiar, this motion is actually referred to as horizontal abduction or horizontal extension. So the piriformis concentrically contracts and pulls the femur in that direction in that plane because of the muscle's relationship to the axis. Okay, so the last axis we're going to look at here is actually going to be going in this direction again. So we have an axis going in this direction. It's running from anterior to posterior or posterior to anterior. And again, now the thigh or the hip is in a different position because the thigh is flexed. So what's the relationship to the muscle and the anterior posterior axis? Well, if I put the muscle back in here, and it's attaching, of course, to the same places, but now the thigh is flexed. What's the muscle's relationship to that axis? Well, because the muscle is above that axis, I don't know if you can see that, that's a little harder to see. It would be above that axis. Again, the head of the femur would have to be right on the acetabulum. But because it's above the axis when the thigh is flexed, okay, you're going to see that muscle now can do the opposite of what it was doing when the femur or thigh was in anatomical position. So again, looking at the pelvis and the femur, if the piriformis was to concentrically contract, that muscle being above the axis would rotate the femur in that direction. So again, the thigh is flexed, we'll say to 90 degrees at the hip joint. The muscle is above the anterior posterior axis. It concentrically contracts to pull the femur in that direction, which we would call medial rotation or internal rotation. So again, that's a rotation. It's occurring in the transverse plane when the thigh is flexed at the hip joint. Now down here, we said the same thing about the muscle. So in this position, and this is one of the reasons why, or this is the reason why the piriformis is one of the deep six lateral rotators, is because in this position, we said that same muscle, the piriformis, would rotate the thigh or femur laterally. So we would call that lateral rotation or external rotation in the transverse plane, right? So that's still rotation, it's still in the transverse plane, but that's when the femur or thigh is in anatomical position. We take that same muscle out of anatomical position, and now in that same plane, it's capable of doing the exact opposite thing at the hip joint, which we would call medial rotation. So it's really important to look at what muscles can do outside of what we call anatomical position. And then the question is, can the muscle actually do what it's supposed to do at the right time? And very often when we ask these questions of the muscle, we actually find that the muscle's not capable of doing what it's supposed to do in the position it's supposed to do it. Or another way to say it, it actually can't do what the anatomy books say it can do in that position. So that's just something to think about. Another thing to think about is when you ask those questions, very often you can get a lot of answers. And when you go to the attachments of the muscle, in this case, the anterior surface of the sacrum and over to the trochanter, now you improve that input to the muscle so the muscle can actually play its role in any position. And then, of course, you add a bunch of other muscles that play similar roles at the joint or even different roles but cross the same joint. And then that translates to when the foot's on the ground. So what we really need to do is isolate out to say, wow, can this muscle actually do what it's supposed to do when we put it in a specific position? And whenever the answer comes back is no, we can actually restore the input to the muscle so that it actually can do what it's supposed to do when you turn it back on or get it back online. And that will transfer to the ground. So just something to think about. And we haven't even covered everything that the piriformis does, because it will actually play a role with the pelvis on the femur when the foot's on the ground. But nonetheless, when you get the muscle back online, or you get a bunch of muscles that cross the same joints back online and doing what they're supposed to do at the right time, that will change so many things throughout the chain when the person's actually trying to function in an environment that allows them to move in three planes of motion. Okay, so hopefully you like this video, hopefully you got something from this, but really, if nothing else, you can see how involved one muscle can be at a joint. And I think a lot of times that's not always clear, because people make it out to be much more simpler than it actually is. Thanks for joining us.